Today, 18 of May, year 2024. Today we talk about Adha. No? There are two kinds of Adha. Jnana Digarana Madha Saduido Jivada Brahmadadi. People without practical experience as now, as the yogis are gaining now, still have the belief in a Adha, despite the calling themselves Buddhist. It seems to them that there is a living being or a person, and they believe firmly in it, a big being, a big Adha rules. This the small self from above. When he says, sit down, the small self, small Adha, has to sit down. Stand up, and the small Adha has to stand up. It seems as if the small Adha has to do as he commands. It seems there is a bigger Adha, and some of the family believe that there is the one. These the beliefs existed in the old days in India, and they exist all over the world. For the general information of the yogis, let me explain about the Adha in brief from the text called Niyaya, written in India. Why should this be explained? The Buddha was a person who professed Anatta Vada, the teaching of Anatta. He said that mental and physical dharma that arise and pass away are called existence and have no Adha, as they say there is. Buddha denied the existence of Adha and professed the correct doctrine called Anatta. People who are the practice in meditation and those who study should know where this word Anatta come from. First of all, the authors of the Niyaya text explain the meaning of Adha, saying, Jnana Digarana Madha. Jnana Digarana Madha means the base for knowledge. Beings to know, animals choose to possess the knowing. The place where this the knowing resides is the Adha. No one exists based on this Adha. If there is no Adha, no knowing mind the occurs, no knowledge the occurs. This is how they explained the role of Adha. Saduvida, Saduvido. This the Adha is of the two kinds, One kind is Jiva Adha, and the other is Brahma Adha. Jiva Adha means life. It is a type of element in living beings that makes them able to move. They got that Jiva Adha. There is the Brahma Adha that gives the orders to this the Jiva Adha from the above. In every living being, there is a life force. The boss, Brahma Adha, rules this life force. See, and the life force sees, hear, and it hears, smell, and it smells, taste, and it tastes, touch, and it touches, lift, and it lifts, move, and it moves, please, and it pleases. There is little Jiva Adha that must follow according to the comments from above. The author of Stanya describes the respective qualities of these two. They say it governs Isro. There is a Brahma Adha that rules the non-living planet Earth, the water, land, forests, and mountains on the planet, and all the various living beings here. Next, it knows all. There is the to be known, called Sabbinyu. That is called Brahma Adha. There is the only one, called the Eko Eva. This means nothing is comparable to it. Next, it is said, Sukadi Rahido, free of happiness, free of the suffering, and so on. It has no happiness of the world's being, nor this the comfort of the suffering. In that word, the Adi and the so on refers to other qualities, such as being free of form, without the length or size. It rules the entire world. It knows everything that is to be known. There is the only one. It has no happiness, suffering, form, and so on. This is how the Brahma Adha is characterized. After this, Jiva Adha means a living self, living Adha. It is the life within each living being, and not only within each being. They believe that even green plants have a life faculty. ek indriya. As the form, the jiva adda, it is the device within living beings, individual bodies. It is various. Each and everyone is the different. If the being is the small, it's the other is small. An ant has a small other because it is small. An elephant has a big other because it has a big body. Other varies according to the being. Another quality it has is the explained as the vibhu. Vibhu means it knows the everything. It is spread out and knows all at once. Because it is diffused and knows means that it roots everything. The life force that is spread throughout all the living beings governs them. They say that the other within the body, the other orders the living beings to act. If it says sit, they sit down. Stand up and they stand up. Go and they go. Stop and they stop. Lie down and they lie down. They attribute this quality to the small self, jiva adda. They also say that the body of the beings, where the jiva adda resides, may get the sick, may age, may feel pain, and may die. At some point, this body is sure to pass away. But the other doesn't die, they say. It is everlasting, called nature. When this existence comes to an end, and once the lifetime is passed away, the small other doesn't die. It doesn't follow along and die the way the body does. It exists. It moves to another body and comes back again. This is what they believe. If you want to know definitely, mind and matter, cause and effect occurring in the relation at the moment of lifting, you must concentrate and observe respectfully. You should not think about how this is the cause. That is the result in the moment of lifting. According to theoretical knowledge, If you think and then do the practice, you cannot get real personal knowledge. You cannot get real personal knowledge. Thinkings will overwhelm the mind, and it will no longer know the kosher, the resident dhammas that are really there in the moment of lifting. If the lifting appears, the duty of the yogi is to apply mental energy and aim the mind from the very slightest beginning of its appearance to the end. This is the only task. There is no other. The mind is clean and pure. If these factors are present, there is no wanting and the lover. Nor is there any depression or the anger, dosa. The unhappiness that follows dosa, God's dominasa, does not arise either. The mind is free of these. It's free of blame and ridicule. Purity brings immediate results. First of all, you will come to discern rupa and nama, mata and the mind. At this time, the belief in the self, jiva adda, can drop away. The belief in Brahma Adda can also cease. Father, you come to know how cause and effect occur in a change. The moment lifting happens, observe it steadfastly with the energy and the aiming. The mind is pure and free of the thought. This is truly the good. First, knows the nama and the rupa. Second, cause effect. You come to know this once their practice is correct. You are sure to come to know this. There is knows not the knowing. It is the guaranteed. So, like them, the moment the lifting happens, observe it steadfastly with the energy and the aiming. Okay, repeat after me. The moment the lifting happens, the moment lifting happens, observe it steadfastly with the energy and aiming. The moment lifting happens, observe it steadfastly with the energy and aiming. The mind is the viewer and free of the fault. This is the truly good. First, the note, mind and matter. First, the note, nama and the rupa. Second, the cause and effect. Second, the cause and effect. Yogi comes that do know this when their practice is the correct. Okay, so lighting is the another, no? Pleasing is the another, no? Sitting is the another. Okay, repeat after me. Lighting is the another. Lifting is the another. Lifting is the another. Pleasing is the another. Pleasing is the another. Dropping is the another. Dropping is the another. Sitting is the another. Okay, try. Sitting is. Standing. Walking. Sleeping. Seeing. Rupa is another. Rupa is the another. Vedana. Tinya. Sankhara are another. Sankhara are another. Vijnana. Sadhu. Sadhu. Okay, we stop here. We have another question and answer. No? May you, the practitioner, now meditation, may all the yogis be liberated from all the suffering. Sadhu.
Last Saturday, we have some more questions to be answered. So this question is Diyasa. I used to write a Vipassana and a breathing meditation technique, meaning observation of the breath in and out through the nose and the nostril. Is that similar technique and a similar results? So the observing the breath, breathing in and out, can be samatha, tranquility meditation, or can be vipassana, depending on which phenomena you focus on. If you observe, if you focus on the breath itself, then that would be considered as a samatha. But if you focus on the present phenomena, ultimate phenomena, like the touching, the air touching, sometimes you feel when you breathe in cold or when you breathe out warm, and or you feel touching, if you observe or note or aware of that feeling or touching sensation, That means you are aware of the ultimate phenomena, that's a vipassana. So it depends on where you focus, the anapana itself, I mean the meditation on breath itself can be samatha or a vipassana. So it can be the same as a vipassana, or it can bring the same results. If it is samatha, you will definitely get the samatha benefits. If you focus on the present ultimate phenomena, that's a vipassana, and then you can get the vipassana results. So similarly is for example, you have two people have the same working hours, but the pay can be different, right? Say you work 8 hours, but you may be paid differently, right? So the same object, but the results can be different. So this question is from someone anonymous. When reflecting Maranasati, how does one prevent a wandering mind from occurring? So Maranasati, the contemplation of the certainty of one's death. So Marana may do one. So, death is certain. So, and then we can die anytime, even within a single moment of breath, we can die. Even there, such a short moment or the breathing moment, we can die. So we can die anytime, anywhere. So that means how precious our life is. So that means we have to take advantage of life. So this means we have to make great effort in the practice. So with this contemplation of the death, we will feel really inspired to put great effort in the practice. As a result, there will be no room for wandering mind. That's how we can prevent wandering mind from occurring by means of Maranasati. So we can die today or we can die tomorrow. So before we die, we have to put great effort in the practice. So with that kind of contemplation, we can prevent wandering mind from occurring. So people who sit here, but that the mind is somewhere else, the people are ignorant of the true fact of life, the death. So no one can guarantee, I can see you again next year, or next month, or tomorrow. No one can guarantee. So one more question is from Mr. Ko. When I sit, sometimes a blockage appears around the sternum area or middle of the chest. It seems to increase the stiffness with the rising. However, the feeling also feels tight. The blockage happens usually once in a sitting session, but they happen more than once too. The occasion of blockage usually below the chest, but occasionally I feel it very high up in the chest. What all about, what do all these means? So physical phenomena manifest in different ways to different people, depending on their health condition and physical structure, bodily condition. So we actually they are not your concern. So your concern or your responsibility is whether you are aware of that concurrently, whether you are mindful of it as it is. That's the most important things. So don't be bothered about what it is, but that you're trying to be aware of it as it is. So if you note the present object as it is, so you will become aware of it as it is, and then also that kind of unpleasant sensation naturally, most probably disappear. When it disappear, something else will appear, and the same thing have to be done. You have to note it as it is. Or the teacher may give you advice to note some other objects. And, so whatever object it may be, you have to be aware of it as it is. So as mentioned earlier, you know, depending on your physical structure and your health, there can be many different physical phenomena. The point is the most important, what matters most is to be aware of them as they really are. Oh, one more question. So, dear Bande, beside the qualities of the Triple Gem and then the Mangala Sutta, in the morning when Sierra's chanting, should I just listen to the psalms, or should I, as a yogi, learn to understand and recognize the meaning of the chanting? On TMC website, there are 7 daily chantings, but only a few have translation. And so of course, it is good to understand the meaning of the chanting, any chanting. If we understand the meaning of chanting, of course, it's better. Then maybe we may have better benefits. Like even the Namo Tassa, Bhagavato, Arahato, and so on. It's good to understand the meaning. It's better to understand. But if we spend our too much time trying to understand the chanting, that is you waste your time for the practice. So during the retreat, the most important thing is to put all out effort in the practice, the constant mindfulness. So when we do chanting, like the qualities of the Buddha or Metta chanting, so that some people, they happy to do chanting in Pali. But actually, understanding is more important than the language you use. So you may use your own language like English, and it's not necessary to do chanting like chanting Pali, right? So is that. So here, second question is my correct? There are more than 250 ways, actually 520 ways in even in Metta chanting to radiate loving kindness to. I forgot how many. So Metta means the wishing, living being happiness. And it's literally we have 520 kind of wishes, like the 1,500 kinds of kilesa. So this literal numbers. So metta means wishing. Wishing living being or individual being happiness. And so we have 520 kind of wishing. So first of all, the 12 kinds of living beings. I mean, the living beings are classified into 12 kinds. That is sabbe sadda, all living beings, sabbe bana, all breathing beings, sabbe buddha, all born beings, sabbe pogala, all individual, sabbe adabhava priya bana, corporeal beings, and then sabba etio or female, me, and then noble people, and then also ordinary people, all deity, all human, all woeful spirits, all together, we have 4 kinds of living beings. So we send our 4 wishes to 12 beings each. Sabbe sadda, all living beings, avira hondu, they all being free from empty or free from mental suffering, free from physical suffering. They may all be take care of themselves happily. So we send our wishes in 4 ways. May they be free from danger and enmity. May they be free from mental suffering. May they be free from physical suffering. May they be able to take care of themselves happily. So the 4 ways of wishing multiplying by 4 kinds of being, and then we got 48 wishing, right? That's plain 48 wishing. And then, and then now we send these 48 wishing into 10 directions. So the eastern, east direction, west direction, something like this. So 48 wishing multiplying by 10 direction, you get 480, right? And a plain wishing is a 48. Plain wishing 48, multiplying blind direction wishing 480, you got 528 wishes. That's what we call 528 kinds of metta, literal number. So development of loving kindness is, of course, very good practice. But that during the Vipassana retreat, it's not necessary to take too much time for metta development like that. 520, so you may take too much time. So these are, metta is one of the 4 guardians meditation. And so yogi here practice for Gaudiya meditation, 1 minute each. I was just about 1 minute each, no more than that, because you are expected to put your time and energy, you devote time and energy to the vipassana practice. So you just need to develop metta by wishing, may all living beings be well and happy or free from danger, enmity, and something like this. You need to take just 1 minute for each Gaudiya meditation. Because we have, you have to devote all your time and energy to vipassana practice. So, by observing whatever objects are obvious, whatever objects are prominent, you can develop the mindfulness, concentration, and vipassana insight. So in this way, your concentration and vipassana insight gradually mature and mature, culminating into liberation. So may you be able to be liberated from the torturous cycle of suffering sooner rather than later. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.